back friends, welcome to another video session from Somos Biology. And in this video tutorial, we'll be talking about sandwich ELISA. We have talked about ELISA as a whole, as a technique, we've already talked about it. And it's my idea to just go back there and understand that process very well, because in this video, I'm not going to talk very tiny details of ELISA. I just talk about a branch of ELISA, that is sandwich ELISA. And there are different branches also called direct ELISA, indirect ELISA and stuff. But there's a difference between sandwich ELISA and direct indirect ELISA. Sandwich ELISA is in this case much more sensitive compared with direct or indirect ELISA. It's almost 2 to 5 times more sensitive. Now first things, why we do ELISA? ELISA process is done due to the detection of antigens that are present in our body. You know, antigens are definite indications of infection or infective agents in our body. Antigen means the fragmentized portion of bacterial cell or viral particles in our body. So if antigen is present, if we can detect a specific antigen, we can tag it with a specific disease and we understand about that disease for that person. So we detect diseases using the detection of antigens using ELISA techniques, or there are other immunological techniques like RIA and stuff. Then sandwich ELISA, the idea is, the name sandwich came because the process steps, as we are going to study, you will see, in this case, antigen is trapped between two antibodies. So it's something like this. If I draw it in very, very basic drawing for understanding, this is the antibody. It is actually stuck, the antigen is actually, this is the antigen, it actually stuck between two different antibodies. So it just looks like a sandwich. Something is in the middle, two things on the top. So that's why it's known as sandwich ELISA technique. Now in any ELISA technique, the idea is very simple. The idea is, this is the antigen, okay? So patient sample contains the antigen. Mostly we use patient serum because it contains the antigen. So what we know specific antibody that can bind with that antigen. Let's say this is the antigen Z. Antigen Z that we want to find in patient's blood. So we know about the antigen Z, so we can design a specific monoclonal antibody that can bind with the antigen Z. So we prepared that monoclonal antibody. This is the antibody. Let's name it as antibody Z, which binds with antigen Z. So we can design it in the lab. And if we know about the stuff that antigen Z binds with antibody Z, we can also design another antibody that can be a primary antibody or something. That antibody is also another monoclonal antibody, say Z2, let's say this is Z1, that will also bind with antigen Z. So here what we require, we are trying to figure out the presence of a specific antigen, this is antigen Z. So in that case, we require two different specific antibody against two different epitopes of that same antigen, because these two antibodies are not binding to the same epitope, because if they bound, that creates problem. We want them to bound in the opposite region of the antigens, so we need two separate epitopes of the antigen where the antibodies will bound. So we need a specific antigen which we need to figure out, which we need to detect. Along with that, we require two antibody that are very specific towards two different epitopes of that antigen. So once you know that, then we are ready to go for the experiment. So this is what we need to know, and this is what we create in the lab. And what we create is small plates. Those plates contain wells, grooves. If I draw this, it can't be drawn in the two-dimensional space like that, but the idea is, this is small grooves, every groove, and groove looks something like this. One after another, there will be grooves. Groove means antibodies can be bound at the bottom, okay? And you can add antigen. Let's say here that this same reaction, if we go on, this is the antigen. And again, you can put some other antibody there, like that. So this is how the things will go on. And we have a series of that chamber that contains small, tiny groups, filled with groups. And now what we do, we fix a specific antibody at the beginning. This is antibody Z1, we fix it at the very beginning. We call them the fixed antibody. And we also know what antigen to detect. So the grooves only contain the fixed antibody only. That's what it looks like, the kit looks like. Now, so say at the very beginning, it will look something like this. Okay, this is the beginning. Don't forget about this stuff. This is the beginning. Antibody Z1. And we know this antibody Z1 is specific to bind with antigen Z only. It will not bind to any other antigen. So if now what we do, we add the sample. Now if our sample contains two, there are two possibilities. It can contain the antigen or it may not contain the antigen. If our sample contains the antigen, it is going to attach and bind with antibody Z1 because this is the antigen Z. Okay. And then what we do a wash up. Okay. After applying the sample, we do a wash up. Why wash up is required? Wash up is very, very important stage, because this washing stage will help us to remove any unbound antigens. Okay. Because the bound antigens will be fixed with the antibody, because the antibody is anchored properly into the slide well or the slide basement. So we wash them off. Now let's say antigen is present. So rest unbound antigens will be washed away. Now the scenario is like this. Then what we add another antibody. Remember, I told you we require two antibodies. So we attach one antibody at the kit, and also we have another antibody in the solution. This antibody we have in the solution, and that solution also comes from the kit. Okay, this antibody solution, and this antibody is known as the tracking antibody. It's also known as the primary selectable antibody, which selects or identifies the antigen, okay, or tracking antibody, whatever you say. This is also primary antibody, because you know primary antibody's work is just to attach to the antigen. That's it. Primary antibody is not going to give you any expression. Okay, for the expression we need secondary antibody. So this is the thing. This sandwich is prepared. Then we have the second solution that also comes from the kit, and that second solution contains another antibody that is anti-primary antibody. That means that antibody can interact with this previous antibody, and that antibody is secondary because that is attached to enzyme. Sometimes we can use a primary antibody which is directly attached to the enzyme, but that is costlier to produce and the specificity cannot maintain all the time. For that reason, we use two different antibodies for the detection. This is only target, and then we have the solution 2. It contains secondary antibody. It's also enzyme linked antibody. Okay, so this secondary antibody will come and join this whole process. So let me draw it here. So here we go, the whole process that we know of: antigen attached, the primary antibody also attached. Let's draw it small way. And now the secondary antibody. And secondary antibody is linked with enzyme. The enzyme could be different. Horseradish peroxidase or HRP is used generally as enzymes here. Now this is the secondary antibody. This is the primary antibody. Now this secondary antibody once bind to this primary antibody with the enzyme complex, then we add some substrate. And they break this substrate. This enzyme will break this substrate down into a product. Okay. And that product is colorful. And we get the color. So in the wells, if you just watch this process now, you see development of colors in the solution. And development of colors will indicate the samples that you use, whether they contains the antigen of your interest or not. Okay. So ultimately, but the idea or the mechanism behind this is this that we talked about. Every time we do each of the stages, we do a wash off. Middle there is a wash, is a washing stage every time we are doing it, because we don't want to keep any unbound antigens or antibodies in the mixture. Because if antigen antibody, even if it's floating in the mixture, still it's going to give us some color. We don't want to do that. That will be false negative. We only want the fixed antigens to give us the result only. For that, we need wash off stages consecutively every after every this stage. Okay, and it will produce the colored product. We get the idea. That is known as sandwich ELISA, because the antigen is getting sandwiched between two antibodies. for the detection of the antigen. Now, if we talk about the advantages of sandwich ELISA over other types of ELISA, sandwich ELISA is much more sensitive compared with direct or indirect ELISA, 2 to 5 times more sensitive. And another important thing about the sandwich ELISA is that in this case of sandwich ELISA, that does not require, this whole process do not require in the purification of the sample that we take. While in direct or indirect ELISA, we need to go for some purification of the sample or preparation of the sample phase that will take time as well as some expense. But in this case, we don't need that. We just take the crude sample extract and we use it. Why we can use that? Why we cannot do that for direct or indirect ELISA? Because as we are separating, as we are finding the antigen based on two different antibody entrapment, it is very, very specific. So even if you have a complex mixture with so many different things, so many antigens, different types of antigens with different epitopes, but still this process can be very handy to find you the specific target antigen of your interest. But if you use it for any other type of ELISA, it might not. So that's the very important advantage of sandwich ELISA that we know of, okay? But the disadvantage is, at the beginning of designing this experiment, you need to know, you need to have a very good understanding of the antigen that we need to separate, and also according to that antigen, you need to design a pair of antibody that will bind to two different epitopes of that antigen. Because if the epitope ranges are same or very close, then it might not end up with good results. So the calibration of this whole experiment is difficult. Except for that, once you calibrate the stuff for a specific antigen, you can run that antigen as many times or samples as many times as you want to identify your antigen of interest. So that's all about sandwich ELISA. If you like this video, please hit the like button and definitely subscribe to my channel to get more and more videos like that. The subscription link is given here as well as in the bottom. So please do subscribe and keep watching. Thank you.